Macmillan Audio presents They May Not Mean To, But They Do by Cathleen Schine. Read for you by Cynthia Darlow. Chapter 1. Molly Bergman moved to California, and it broke her mother's heart. There are daughters who spend their lives trying to escape their mothers, who move to their particular California the minute they're able to, who never stop moving to California. Molly was decidedly not one of those daughters. It was a painful move even before her parents got so suddenly so old. Molly's mother was named Joy, and people said, oh, they broke the mold when they made that one. People who loved her said it, people who did not love her said it too, for the same reason. They found Joy disconcerting, and they were right. She was so intimate and so remote as a faraway nameless planet sometimes, sometimes soft and sympathetic. She was talkative, yet she heard everything you said or thought you might say. She was wise, and she was deep, intuitive, the kind of person to whom people confided their darkest secrets. She was scatterbrained and easily distractible and often forgot people's darkest secrets, which, she always said, was just as well. She seemed to Molly, growing up, to be the busiest and most important mother in New York City. Joy's work was her vocation. That's what Joy said when she was happy. When she was frustrated and tired, she said it was a velvet coffin without the velvet. She was also beautiful, radiantly beautiful, like a doe, fragile and supple and quick. She was blonde, but her eyes were as brown as a doe's. When she smiled, everyone around her smiled, and she smiled a great deal, though it was often from abstraction rather than any particular moment of happiness. She loved New York because, she liked to say, she fit in with all the misfits. Molly and her brother Daniel began their lives with Joy and their father, Aaron, in a two-bedroom apartment with dinette on the west side of Manhattan, the dinette converted into a third bedroom. Their neighbors were immigrants from Eastern Europe, emigres from Brooklyn, teachers and violinists and opera singers. You could hear the opera singers as you walked down Broadway, arias amid car horns. There were mom-and-pop dress shops and dairy restaurants and bakeries, and Molly remembered the square rooms, the high ceilings, the shutters that folded in on themselves, the deep windowsills on which she used to sit and look out at the street. But when Molly was 8 and her brother 6, their father inherited his family's manufacturing business, and the Bergmans left West 89th Street. Aaron said the West Side was becoming seedy. There were fewer Eastern European immigrants and Brooklyn escapees on Park Avenue. No dairy restaurants, more Gentiles. It was a quiet, civilized neighborhood, at least until late afternoon when the private schools let out. Molly and Daniel still went to their progressive private school on the West Side, but when Molly got off the bus, she could already hear the commotion of the East Side children at the corner store. She always waited for them to leave the store before buying her own candy, and secretly envied them their noisy cabal and, even more secretly, their school uniforms. "Across the park is as far as we go," Joy declared. "No farther, Aaron." Daniel did go a bit farther when he grew up. He and his wife Coco and their two little girls lived on the Lower East Side. That was inexplicable to Joy and Aaron, moving to the tenements their grandparents had left behind. Inexplicable, yes, but accessible by subway, Joy said to Molly. The Bergmans were New Yorkers, she said, and had always been New Yorkers. This was a fact, in a way, that Molly's move to Los Angeles could never be. Each time Molly left New York after a visit, Joy felt the air go out of the city. You're too attached, one of her friends said. My daughter lives in Australia. Joy shuddered. A daughter in Australia might as well be a dead daughter. Divorce was a terrible thing, and she was sorry Molly had given up a perfectly reasonable husband so she could be a lesbian in California. It was peculiar having a lesbian daughter, though plenty of her friends did too, it turned out. But many things were peculiar in this world. And Joy had overcome her discomfort with Freddie. She even called her my daughter-in-law now. Freddie was a lot of fun. Warm, kind, gainfully employed, and low maintenance. Everything a mother-in-law could ask for. Joy did not blame her for being a woman, or tried not to. Molly was happy. Joy could see that, and it warmed her heart. But what good is a warmed heart if it is also broken? Joy's heart was broken. My California. California. Even the name had become ugly to Joy, like Lee Harvey Oswald or Sirhan Sirhan. Joy's parents had moved several times during the Depression, first to places where someone could take them in, then to places where they took others in. Each move was a shock to Joy, an almost physical jolt. So many people left behind. Shopkeepers, neighbors, the policeman on the corner, the ladies sitting on their stoops. They were what made a place a home. There were so many things one had to give up in this world. Why would you choose to give up your home? For California? Perhaps she should move to California too. Aaron might not know the difference. Would you like to move to California, Aaron? Come if you dare, our trumpets sound, he sang. Come if you dare, the foes rebound. He could not tell you what day it was, but he remembered his Purcell. It was Sunday, and she had ordered him a dinner of French toast from the coffee shop. New York was good for the elderly in that way, the deliveries. She had come to include Aaron in the category of the elderly, she realized with a pang. And where does that leave me? She wondered vaguely. At any rate, it was too difficult sometimes to herd Aaron and his walker out of the apartment and down the street to the coffee shop. She could have made French toast, she supposed, if there had been eggs. Or bread. If she still cooked. Isn't there a joke? We could have ham and eggs if we had ham. And we had eggs. They laughed, repeated it. We could have ham and eggs. Aaron took a bite of French toast and made a face. You love French toast, Aaron, so stop it.
Do I?
He was hunched over the dining room table. There was a bath mat on the seat of his chair, as well as a blue chucks pad. Joy leaned over and straightened them.
Are you going to work today? He said.
No, dear, it's Sunday.
Oh, yeah?
He took a bite of French toast and made another sour face.
Stop that, she said. Anyway, you need a haircut. You going to work today? He said.
Sometimes Joy thought he was doing it on purpose.
No, not today. Today is Sunday. Oh, yeah? What is this anyway? He said, poking at the French toast. Your dinner. I'm not hungry.
Joy grabbed his plate and brought it to the kitchen and scraped the French toast into the garbage.
Joy! Joy!
She stuck her head back into the dining room.
You going to work today? He asked.
If you ask me that one more time, I'm putting a bag over your head, she said mildly.
Aaron brought his face down to the teacup and took a sip, then looked fondly at his wife. He pointed to the cup of almost colorless liquid.
Join me, sweetheart.
He began to sing in his once clear voice, now heavy and hoarse.
Tea for two, me for you,
he sang pleasantly to himself while Joy fetched herself a cup of tea, and they sat looking out at the traffic's red brake lights, something they'd both always found festive as the evening drew in. Chapter 2 Molly had been a daddy's girl when she was very young. Her father was the only father she knew who had a beard, and the beard, a neatly combed beard that came almost to a point, was her pride and joy. He would carry her inside his coat, against his chest, like a kangaroo,
and she would snuggle her face against his, against that extraordinary beard. Her father and his beard were so obviously superior to other fathers with their flabby pink cheeks. Her father was superior in height as well. He was so tall that she and Daniel used him as a unit of measurement. How many daddies high was that tree in the park? What about the elephants at the Museum of Natural History? It was Aaron who read to them when they were little. Push me, pull yous, and the cat's meat man, bump, bump, bump down the stairs. Books that had been his. Books he wished his father had read to him. He bundled up the children and led them to the roof to look at the constellations. He took them out to the park to climb the rocks and along the river to the boat basin to play pirates and launch paper boats that tipped and sank while they sang Blow the Man Down. It was Aaron who encouraged them, egged them on when they begged for a dog. Aaron who went to the animal shelter with them to get a cat when Joy had expressly forbidden it. Aaron's father had failed him when he was a child, too busy steering the business out of the depression. Aaron would never do that to his children, he told Joy. True to his word, she would say later, it was the business he failed. Aaron and Joy were so different from each other that Molly and Daniel had been able to recognize the distance even as young children. Aaron, sentimental and unreliable and brimming with love and obvious charm, a man who made you feel you did not have to work too hard because good things were coming to you from somewhere. Joy, distracted, forgetful, thoughtful, brimming with love too, and oddly inspiring, causing Molly and Daniel to want to work their hardest because working hard seemed such fun. Molly wasn't sure why she compared them to each other like that, as if she had to make a choice, as if she could make a choice, because different as they were, there was no choice between them, no space between them. They were as one. They held hands when they walked down the street. They fed each other tidbits like lovebirds. It was embarrassing for the children, having such lovey-dovey parents, and reassuring, like the trumpeters and singers in the Bible. They were as one. Chapter 3
You'd better come home, Joy said to Molly on the phone. Daddy's on the floor.
He fell? Molly tried to calm herself. Is he okay? Did you call 911?
He slid out of his chair. I never should have gotten it in leather. I gave him a cracker.
Mom!
The handyman's coming in a minute. He'll get Daddy up. Never a dull moment, right, Aaron?
The phone was handed to Aaron.
Never a dull moment.
Daddy, are you all right?
Your mother gave me a cracker.
I'll be home soon, Molly said. She repeated it when her mother got back on the phone. I'll be home soon, Mom. I arranged an extra week off in November.
November?
A pause.
Oh.
Then,
wonderful, Molly. And how are your students this semester?
Molly heard the strain in her mother's voice and hurried through a rundown of some of the more interesting students. Anyway, nothing to write home about.
Daddy's having a hard time, Molly. He gets confused sometimes.
I know, but he does have dementia.
Don't be disrespectful.
Joy didn't like the word dementia. Alzheimer's was worse. Sorry, Molly said. I just meant, you know, it's natural that he'd be confused and forget things.
Well, he doesn't like it. He doesn't like it one bit. And he doesn't admit it, which is tiring for me, I can tell you.
Maybe we can't afford it.
Well, what about absolutely not?
Not a home, exactly.
He has a home, Joy said. His home is here.
Molly poured herself two fingers of bourbon, just as her father had taught her. No bourbon for him these days. Just ensure. Many fingers of ensure. I should be home, she said to Freddy. I'm a horrible daughter. I might as well shoot myself. Freddy thought, you are home, Molly.
How many times can the doorman scrape him off the floor? At least she tips them at Christmas.
I really have to go back. It's...
What about your brother?
What about my brother?
Now they would have a fight.
I don't want to have a fight, Freddy said.
Then don't mention my brother.
Ever?
See, you do want to have a fight.
She went out to the garden and Freddy followed. It was 6 o'clock and still hot, which was unusual where they lived, near the beach on the west side of Los Angeles. It had been an unusually hot summer, though. Molly brushed miniature pink petals off the chaise before sitting.
Autumn leaves, she said, examining.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.